Hi everyone. Thanks for joining us today at ABRF for our virtual presentation, Creating Core Demand with HiFi Sequencing. My name's David Miller. I'm a senior director here in the product marketing group at PacBio. And it's my pleasure today to be joined by Alvaro G. Hernandez, who's the director of DNA services at UIUC. Alvaro, welcome.
Hi David, nice to be here.
Thanks so much for joining us. Today, what I'd like to do is kick us off with Alvaro giving us a bit of an introduction to the core lab that he runs and the services he provides, and talking a little bit about where PacBio sequencing fits in within the core. So Alvaro, why don't I pass it over to you to take us through a brief introduction.
Great. Thank you, David. And thank you, PacBio, for inviting me and giving me the chance to talk about the work that we do at the DNA Service Facility at the University of Illinois. All the core facilities at the University of Illinois are under the umbrella of the Roy Calvert Biotech Center, so we are very centralized. We have facilities for bioinformatics, DNA sequencing, functional genomics, proteomics, flow cytometry, and metabolomics. Specifically in the DNA service facility, we are 12 people. This picture is pre-COVID, so it's very difficult to get new pictures during COVID times. We are 12 people and we are dedicated to doing DNA and RNA sample quality control, making libraries, doing sequencing runs, and of course, a lot of user support. The way we do our work is through two Illumina Nova 6 6000. We also have three MI6. We have a PacBio SQL 2. We have an Oxford Nanopore Gridion, and finally two 10x Chromium systems. Our users are from all over, the University of Illinois, but also from all over the United States. We have users both in academic institutions as well as in private companies. And actually the majority of our work comes from other countries. We have a lot of users in Israel, in Germany, Brazil, Chile, Mexico, and many other countries. And this wide user base means that we get all samples from all sorts of animals, all sorts of plants, and bacteria. So, and many of these species are species that don't have a reference genome. So a lot of a significant amount of the work that we do is in de novo genome assembly and creating the resources for everything that comes after you have a genome, such as genome resequencing, RNA-seq, epigenomics, and so on. So a significant amount of our work is in non-model species. Regarding the applications that we run in the core, for the NovaSeq, we run all the applications that need either a very high sequencing depth or that involve a very large number of samples, such as RNA-seq, DNA sequencing, resequencing, whole genome metagenomics, and so on and so forth, and also all the work that involves a single cell. For the MI-seq, in the MI-seq, we run mostly metagenomics projects that need, when samples need amplification of 16S for bacteria, for archaea, ITS, 18S, and other functional genes, we use the fluid and microfluidic system to create these libraries that are sequenced in the MI-seq. We also use it to sequence some bacteria, small viruses, targeted regions, and we use it a lot for library QC, so to make sure that there is even pooling before libraries are sequenced in the NovaSeq. We do a lot of single cell work, both for RNA-seq, ATAC-seq, now multiomics, which is both RNA-seq and ATAC-seq, and also now for Visium spatial transcriptomics. We also have a PacBio SQL 2, and we are now in the process of upgrading it to the SQL 2e. We use the SQL 2 mostly for de novo genome assembly with HiFi reads. Also, most of our metagenomics projects have switched from sequencing a region of the 16S to sequencing the full-length 16S in the PacBio. The reason for that is that we get a much better classification down to the species level when we sequence the full-length. Now we are also testing a new library prep that amplifies 16S, ITS, and 23S so that you get a much better classification down to the strain level. And now we also started seeing that some customers are requesting a whole genome metagenomic sequencing in the PacBio. We are also doing full-length transcriptome ISO-seq, not only for annotation of the genome that we assemble, but also because PIs need to know, not only which genes are in their samples, but also what are the spliced variants that are present there. We also use it for several to sequence long amplicons or targeted regions up to 20 kb. And we are now testing it for de novo assembly of bacteria. The reason why we have the SQL 2 is because of the very high demand for de novo assembly on non-model species. Also, there is very high demand for 16S metagenomic sequencing. And as I said, we are getting much better results by sequencing the full-length 16S. And I was very skeptical about the previous PacBio instruments. But once the SQL 2 came out, the much higher outputs and the longer read lengths were more like a non-brainer. You know, it was time to get the SQL 2. And our queue got full right away after we acquired it. And we also have a gridion that we use it when for projects that involve one or a few bacteria, or if we want to sequence a direct RNA. We also have Sanger sequencing. We have 237 XLs. This is a very busy project. Sanger sequencing is not going away anytime soon. I wanted to give an example of a very exciting HiFi project that we have. We are sequencing 10 insects. This is a proof of concept project for the Earth Biogenome project. One of the insects was an Achillidae. This is a plant hopper, has a 5 millimeter body length. And we were able to extract 2.1 micrograms of high molecular weight DNA. And our initial sequencing gave us an expected genome size of about 1.2 gigabases. So we decided to sequence two smart cells. So we made one HiFi library and we sequenced 1.5 smart cells. And from 1.5 smart cells, we got 32 gigabases of HiFi data with an average read length of 14 KB. Now the assembly, these are the assembly metrics. We assembled the genome in 246 contexts. The total genome size was 1.4 gigabases, so very close to what we estimated. And the scaffolding 50 was 72 megabases. Before, this was with PacBio plus OmniC, so we also had to do OmniC libraries. Before OmniC, it was 45 megabases with PacBio only, and after OmniC, it went up to 72 megabases. This is an extreme, and these are the Busco scores. We were able to assemble 97% of the genes with a duplication rate of 1%. So this is an excellent assembly, almost to chromosome level, done with 1.5 flow cells and one OmniC library. So less than $5,000 and a very high quality assembly. I was also asked to say what workplace modifications we have done to due to COVID. What we have done is here everyone wears a mask at all times while on campus. We test 3 times a week. We disinfect. We ask people to do frequent hand washing. We check our temperature twice a day. And we reduce equipment bottlenecks so there are not too many people at the same area at the same time. Our people work on different shifts. So some work from 7 to 3 p.m., some from 9 to 5 p.m., some work on weekends because of childcare issues. And of course, all our meetings, including the lab meeting, are virtual. Another thing that we have done is we have created barriers between workbenches. So and the barriers include plastic or a lot of plexiglass. And all these changes have allowed us to resume full-time working at full capacity at the end of May. So we were shut down part of March and part of April and part of May. But since end of May, we have been working at full capacity with absolutely no issues. And with that, I wanted to say, we are a service facility. We are here to serve. If you have any questions, you are writing proposals, you need letters of support, you want to discuss ideas, or you are ready to publish your paper and we did the sequencing, we can write the materials and methods for you. But always feel free to contact us. So here is my email. Chris Wright is the associate director of the lab. She's an expert in single cell and in other applications. The idea is always to contact the core before submitting the sample so that we can tell you what is a good sample, what is a good DNA, what is a good RNA, how to QC the samples before you bring them here. And also, things change fast. So we have a website that we keep updated, but the idea is always to get in touch with us before you start. And with that, I thank you, and I'll be happy to answer questions, David.
Thanks, Alvaro. That's just, it's fantastic to see what you've built, not only for your users in terms of the technology, but also how you've really got back up and running and made a safe environment through COVID. So again, thank you so much for sharing with us. I guess, you know, it'd be really great to understand from your point of view, you've got a lot of fantastic equipment, as I said, in the lab. How do you guys think about sort of securing the capital and building out that fantastic suite of technologies in the lab?
Yeah, thank you for the question. That's a very important part of the managing the core for us. We have never asked campus for money, and we have never received any federal support for our equipment. What we do is we depreciate our equipment. So we, for example, when we get a new piece of equipment, we depreciate it over 3 years so that we always have the funding to buy new equipment. That's very important for us. I think that the point I want to make is don't try to be cheap, try to be sustainable. If you are cheap, you will not have money to buy equipment. If you make sure that you depreciate your equipment, you will always be able to offer those resources to campus. The way we justify having higher prices than others is, yes, we might be a little bit more expensive, but we offer you these amazing resources. You know, everything that campus needs, we have it.
Really well said. I appreciate it. And I guess to sort of build on the project you spoke about for the Earth Biogenome, are you seeing more sort of demand for multi-omic or multi-technology projects coming in the door where customers really want to use several things to achieve a greater outcome at the end of the day?
Yes, definitely. So for example, the PacBio services is one example of that, in which one of the first things that happened was that, you know, for PacBio, you need high molecular weight DNA, and users are not, you know, they don't have that experience to get and to you know, to extract DNA without fragmenting it. So one of the services we had to offer at the beginning was extraction of high molecular weight DNA. And then, you know, yep, we made the library, we have the sequencing, the assemblies went really fast, but then you need to make that assembly more complete. Now people started asking for chromosome level assemblies. So we had to develop expertise also in making high C libraries, or the ones that we do are the OmniC libraries from Dovetail. So that's another example of another technology that is sequenced with Illumina that complements PacBio extremely well.
It's fantastic. Again, I just thank you so much for joining us today. And it's really exciting to see just the amount of service that you bring to your users and everything you've been able to achieve. So thank you again for sharing that today. And with that, I'd like to sort of start to draw this to a close. Thank you, everyone, for joining us for this brief virtual discussion and chat today. As Alvaro said, there's plenty of ways to get in touch with us. If you have questions, please reach out. If you want to learn more about HiFi or PacBio, or if you're interested in running a project, please reach out to Alvaro and the team at UIUC. So with that, again, thank you so much, and enjoy the rest of the conference.
Thank you.